Clint Eastwood once again is a man with no name and a new Western, his first in 9 years, Pale Rider. I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. We're calling the show, Back in the Saddle Again, The Rebirth of the Western, with the release recently of a whole bunch of new adventure pictures and comedies set in the Old West, including Clint Eastwood's first Western in 9 years, Pale Rider. We're going to take a look at some of these new films, and we're also going to try to explain the many forces that killed the Western. But first, Roger begins with a look at the glory days of Western movie making.
If somebody had suggested 30 or 40 years ago that one day the Western would be a dying genre, and that years would go by without Hollywood making a single successful Western, they would have been laughed right out of the movie industry. But that's exactly what has happened in the last decade, as the Western, which European critics like to call the only original American art form, has seemed to be headed for its last roundup. To see where the great American Western was and how far it's fallen, you can go back and take a look at the one man who seems to symbolize the spirit of American Westerns, and his name is John Wayne. In Howard Hawks' Red River, Wayne was determined to drive a herd of cattle from Texas to Kansas City.
Take him to Missouri, Matt.
And John Ford's The Searchers, he engaged in a mythic search for a niece who had been captured by Indians.
Go searching way out there. His peace of mind, he knows he'll find. But where, oh Lord, Lord, where?
In both of those movies, you can feel the spirit of the Western form of movies and stories and characters that are filled with self-confidence and boundless energy, but you don't often feel that positive force in many of the newer American Westerns, the Westerns, if you will, that help to bury the Western and sometimes right. seem to be very inbred and pessimistic.
There's no question. Look, we've been trying to figure this out when we did research for the show. Now, why did it die? And we're going to get to that in a second. But I'm just telling you, I see that scene in Red River, directed by Howard Hawks, and maybe that's part of the reason that we don't have directors like Howard Hawks. You show that round them up, move them out scene with those cuts of those faces. That is thrilling. People don't know the names of a lot of those actors that are just up there. Those are second bananas, third bananas. And it's thrilling. It has the spirit of the Western. You feel like it might be fun to be a cowboy watching that. Watch some of the newer Westerns. It's not fun to be a cowboy.
Right. It seemed like in the later years of the Western, they were trying to use the Western as a form to take in all kinds of symbolism about what's wrong with American society.
Yes.
In the early days, when you and I were kids going to the movies, cowboys got to ride a horse and round up those cattle and shoot their guns and find the new frontier.
No.
And it was simple, but it was a tremendously positive, energetic force that you don't feel now.
Well, and again, I return to the filmmaking. Howard Hawks. Still working today, the Western doesn't die. Now, after John Wayne, the next great Western hero would turn out to be a young American TV actor who went to Italy to film a new kind of Western movie, extremely violent and with a droll sort of sense of humor. Clint Eastwood was his name, of course, his director, Sergio Leone. And they gave us the Western hero with a new twist. They turned him into a more enthusiastic, less reluctant killer. Talk about enthusiasm, as we can see in this scene in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
Here before us, Tuco Benedicto Pacifico Juan Maria Ramirez,
known as the Rat,
and any other aliases you might hang by the neck until dead. May God have mercy on his soul. Proceed.
In the increasingly cynical 1960s, Clint Eastwood's screen persona was just what the moviegoer ordered. Additionally, as the movie started to become the province of the young, Clint Eastwood, 23 years younger than John Wayne, seemed a much more contemporary hero. He didn't mind admitting that he sort of got a kick out of killing. So, with Clint Eastwood, the Western hadn't died yet. It had just gotten a little younger.
You know, looking at these two together, the two probably greatest Western heroes in the history of American movies, John Wayne and Clint Eastwood, I think they're in the category by themselves. They do have one thing in common, though, even though Eastwood plays a much less positive person and sometimes even plays a villain. They both say hardly anything at all. And Eastwood is famous for taking lines and lines and lines out of his scripts. In those first spaghetti westerns, he threw out two-thirds of the dialogue.
And Wayne always said he was the reactor rather than the actor.
That's right. So you let everybody, let all the townsfolk talk. Let the preacher talk. Let the womenfolk talk. And the guy who just stands there with the light behind him, he's the strong authority figure, which is important
now,
in these films.
It's very important. And I wonder if the time is right now for a return. Because I think what people want now, it seems, you can see in the presidency of Reagan, is a strong leader. And you get it in the Western like no other genre film at all. The one lightning rod, the galvanizing force. You feel secure when you go to a Wayne or Eastwood Western. Somebody's going to take care of business.
You may have something there, Gene, because the Western is not a form for introspection or for second-guessing or for wondering if I did the right thing or not. These are men who take their course of action, see it clear through to the end, and do it.
Yeah.
At least, better or worse.
At least in a commercial sense, where you want to get the audience roused up. I mean, it's possible to make a nihilistic Western, but it probably won't sell. And that, of course, is what is required to keep the Western going.
And especially not at this time where all the adventure movies, even like all the Indiana Jones pictures, are extremely simple. We're back to a time, I think, of reinventing the wheel when it comes to adventure pictures. Next at the movies, we look at some of the forces that may have contributed to the death of the Western. Up a list of some of the forces that helped to kill the Hollywood Western, I think TV, it has to be up pretty close to the top of the list. There was a period in the 1950s and 1960s when Westerns were all over television with shows like Gunsmoke and Rawhide and Maverick and the Have Gun, Will Travel. They all had the same basic good guy, bad guy cliches, and those cliches got overexposed. You got the feeling this is basically the stuff that Westerns are made out of. I'm getting it free hour after hour at home. Have to go out of the house and pay for it? So then came the 1960s and the Vietnam War, and Westerns became politically unpopular with a lot of moviegoers who said one of the problems in Vietnam was that we still thought we could win with John Wayne heroics. And indeed, John Wayne made a Western in battle gear called the Green Berets, which failed at the box office. About the time the war was ending, a death blow was dealt to the Western, if it still needed one, by a new version of the same basic story elements, and that was Star Wars. Because who were those characters in Star Wars, and what situations were they in, and what were their relationships like? They were all straight out of Westerns. And what Star Wars, all the Star Wars movies were basically Westerns set among the stars, a space opera instead of a horse opera. And then, if Westerns weren't in outer space, which was bad enough, where else were they in the movies? They were in big cities, because what was Clint Eastwood's own Dirty Harry but an urban Western?
I know what you're thinking. Did he fire six shots or only five? Well, to tell you the truth, in all this excitement, I kind of lost track myself. But being this is a .44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world, and would blow your head clean off, you've got to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
And you know, Gene, one of the things that you can think about when you look at Star Wars and Dirty Harry and you recognize those same characters, the same confrontations is, in a way, even though Westerns weren't on the screen and characters were not riding around on horses, there was a hunger for that same kind of dichotomy between good and evil and setting, riding into town and setting everything straight. There was a hunger for the story form, even if it didn't have all of the right costumes and locations.
Well, maybe that's a provocative issue. I remember talking to Pauline Kael back around that time in the early 70s, our great film critic, and she said, when I said, you know, there hasn't been a Western, I wonder if it's going to be revived, she says, she did hope that it wouldn't be revived. She didn't think that there were that many great Westerns made, actually. And someone could say, you know, all right, so it changes costume. What's the big deal? How do you answer that one?
I think, how would I answer that? That's a very, I would say, if you can make a good movie, no matter what it is, then it's worth making. And if you make a bad movie, then in that case, it's not worth making. But for a whole genre to go by the boards, and the Western, it seemed to me, at least up until about 10 years ago, was such an important part of all of our imaginations and all of our myth of what America was, that for that to be lost would at least tell us that we had lost an important part of ourselves.
Okay, but there's one reason why the Western died that you didn't mention. It's been said that whenever a type of film can be successfully parodied, made fun of, it's only because everybody is already secretly laughing at it. The comedy Airplane, for example, helped do away with the airport disaster movie. And in the case of the Western, the man, I think, who put the final bullet hole into the Western was Mel Brooks with Blazing Saddles.
Governor, as per your instructions, I'd like you to meet the new sheriff of Rock Ridge.
I'd be delighted.
Wow!
I've got to talk to you. Come here. Have you gone berserk? Can't you see that that man is a nit? Wrong person. Forgive me. No offense intended. Have you gone berserk? Can't you see that that man is a nit?
Don't worry, sir.
Well, Headley, I've always trusted your judgment before, but haven't you taken a giant leap away from your good senses?
Now, that's funny. And, you know, part of the thing with Mel Brooks is, I think, that film was such a huge hit, big hit, that people know it so very well that whenever they see a Western now, or would see a Western now if one came out, I think they're going to be recalling. I mean, campfire scenes are never going to be the same.
Never be another campfire scene like that one. And also, when they're playing it straight and they're being very serious, people can think of the Mel Brooks spin on it.
Right, punching the horse. I mean, that horse scene is a great scene, too.
So maybe the Blazing Saddles came at the end of that period of the Western,
right.
And now maybe it's time for a new period. Or at least there are certainly some people in Hollywood who hope so. Coming up next at the movies, some people who are taking a chance on Westerns in 1985.
This is the West, Pat. People are arbitrarily shot to pieces left and right. I mean, it is all so violent.
It's been a successful Western in a long time, and not a really big one since The Outlaw Josie Wales came out in 1976. This summer, for the first time in a long time, there are going to be several big-budget Westerns opening around the country. Hollywood is once again willing to gamble on the wide-open spaces, and one of their new Westerns is named Rustler's Rhapsody. It's a satire of those great B singing cowboy movies that used to fill up the Saturday matinees back in the 1940s. Tom Berenger stars as a cowboy named Rex O'Hurlihan, who seems to be a combination of Rex Allen, Gene Autry, and Hopalong Cassidy.
Me too.
Somehow that horse is not quite as funny as Lee Marvin's horse in Cap Ballou. I think that kind of was the ultimate last word in funny horses and westerns. Rustler's Rhapsody is not a very funny movie. In fact, it's hardly funny at all, and we've given it already a couple of thumbs down on a regular review program. But it is significant as an investment, as an indication that Hollywood thinks a western can still make money, even a comedy western. Somebody else in Hollywood who hopes the western isn't dead is Lawrence Kasdan, the man who wrote two of the Star Wars movies and helped inspire the return of the old-fashioned adventure movie with his screenplay for Raiders of the Lost Ark. Kasdan has made two movies as a director, Body Heat and The Big Chill, both of them big hits. Now he's taking a chance on a big-budget, serious western named Silverado. The movie takes place in the 1880s. It's about 4 men who try to establish justice in a frontier town, and it stars a roll call of talented young actors, including Kevin Kline, Scott Glenn, Rosanna Arquette, and Linda Hunt, at least three of whom are certainly in their first Western. The movie's coming attractions makes it feel like a cross between Raiders and one of those exuberant classic Westerns. The question of how the new Westerns will do at the box office is still several weeks from any sort of a decision. One of the things that has some of the studios worried, and I find this to be a fascinating sign of the times, is that an actual majority of American moviegoers under the age of 20, and that represents the heart and soul of that teenage movie-going audience in the summertime, these kids have never, ever seen in their lifetimes a real Western in a movie theater before. That is an amazing statistic for them. The age-old American ritual of going out to the movies and seeing a Western is going to be a brand-new experience. One guess I'd like to make is that the Western is headed for a comeback. It's not going to be by the satire or comedy routes. It's not going to be by Rustler's Rhapsody, but by giving new Westerns the same kind of excitement and energy that we feel in the Indiana Jones movies and the old Clint Eastwood spaghetti Westerns. I think if Lawrence Kasdan can find the same kind of energy in Silverado that he found for his screenplays for the Raiders and Star Wars pictures,
right.
If he can put it on a saddle and ride it out there on the prairie, he might have something.
And he's going to need a good director, and I hope he's equal to it. Mm-hmm. That's my point about Howard Hawks directing Red River. Mm-hmm. That kind of energy, I think, will work at any time. And mm-hmm. so it'll really come down to the old traditional things of script and direction. Now, coming up next at the movies, we'll take a look at how the number one box office star in the world is trying to revive the Western, both as actor and as director. Pale Rider is, as we've mentioned before, Eastwood's first Western in 9 years since The Outlaw Josie Wales. To the degree that this picture is a success, corporate Hollywood is going to think one of two things about the Western movies. Executives are going to think either that the Western is alive and well, or that it's only alive and well when Clint Eastwood makes one. And Eastwood's Pale Rider turns out to be a very traditional Western, much like a picture he made in 1972 called High Plains Drifter, featuring Eastwood as a mysterious stranger who comes to the rescue of the meek and mild who are being overrun by bullies. Never misses. Fabulous. Later in the film, Eastwood takes on a half dozen gunfighters who've been hired to kill him. The code of his movies hasn't changed a bit. He still doesn't shoot until somebody tries to shoot him first.
Back to the door.
Well, I reckon all of us don't need that marshal, do we?
I'm not sure why they kept shooting at him at that table, because if we could see that he wasn't there and we're standing behind them in the camera position, why couldn't they see that he wasn't there? But I guess he's a hard guy to see. And it hurts if you don't see him as the scene pays off. Pale Rider is going to be reviewed on one of our regular shows. But for our purpose here, what interests me about the film is that Clint Eastwood has made a very traditional and very violent picture. He hasn't tried to make any kind of revisionist Western. He hasn't tried to make a psychologically complex picture like his last detective film, Tightrope. In Pale Rider, Clint Eastwood simply rides in, destroys the bad guys, gives a little sermon about how the little people of the world must band together to fight evil in the world, and then he rides out of town. And so I guess what Eastwood, the savviest of all the stars possibly, is saying about the Western is that in order to revive the Western, filmmakers must first return to the roots of the Western myth to simple battles between good and evil, which is what we've been saying all along.
I think that's what he's trying to say. Another thing he's doing here is he's very, very, very simple in his presentation of his own character. He is always backlit. You mm-hmm. never see his face in full mm-hmm. light. Mm-hmm. Usually you see part of his face. His mm-hmm. hat comes across right. his face, or he's in shadow. He has very, very, very few words, probably less than 200 words in the entire picture. It goes back to the spaghetti western.
Somebody has a video recorder that's going to tape
they're
this.
They're going to count it up. They're going to count on somewhere in that neighborhood. Okay. And if he comes into town, he comes in town as a mythic
right.
force from the Old West
right.
and from the Old Western.
Right. That's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's it for this special program. Next week at the movies, we're going to be taking a look at Sylvester Stallone in Rambo, First Blood Part 2, one of the big summertime action movies. And until then, we'll see you at the movies.